a static body. Okay, so today's session is the last topic of unit 2, that is a contamination of the media. So any organism which is going to contaminate. So we have studied about the culture media in the last class. Shweta ma'am, please, I don't know whether you're a student or a lecturer, I don't know. Shweta ma'am, please mute yourself, ma'am. Yeah, thank you so much. Yeah, so in the previous sessions, we have completed with the different types of media, the ingredients of the media, and how they are useful and what type of microorganisms were cultured on the different media. So as we all said that media is the base, or it is a food material for the fungal, not only the fungal, basically for all the microorganism, food material, right? So when the media is exposed to the environment, many organisms except our desired one, including that all the organisms, they will try to attract towards that media and they will make it as a base for their growth. But whatever we are doing in the laboratory condition, that we are doing it in an aseptic manner. That means to say it should be free from the all the contaminants. Okay, so we require only the desired organism to be cultured and not all the unnecessary one. So for that we are doing the sterilization. That also we have done with our in the previous sessions. So many sterilization methods are adopted just to kill the unwanted or undesired microorganisms growing in the surrounding environment or on the media what we have prepared. So the basic fungal contaminants what are generally growing or surviving on the culture media, so that is a topic we are going to discuss today. So I'm start sharing my screen. Yeah, so this is a fungal contaminant. So we are talking about today of four fungal contaminants. So what is a contaminant actually? The pathogen, generally we call it as an infectious agent or a pathogen, which is spoiling the base or the food material or any other organic material. That we call it as a contaminant. Any organism which is toxic or pathogenic, spoiling the environment where they are going to stay. So that we call it as a contaminant. So among the fungal organisms, these four are the basic contaminants which always cause a lot of loss to the laboratory, that is to the people who are working on the mycological techniques or on the tissue culture or any other techniques, that what they are adapted or what they are doing their work. These are the always be the first contaminants to be observed on the culture media. So just we'll go one by one. How, what is that fungal organism? What is the morphology of it? How it is reproducing? Then why we are calling exactly that particular organism as a contaminant? Because they have a very rich source of spore producing. Okay, the spores are the one which are the major contaminants on the media where they are surviving. So the spores, they generally transmit, or the spores are the one which will transmit the hyphal growth, or they can transfer, they can help in the production, reproduction of that particular organism within no time. So the spore, these are all the spore producing fungal organism which are very fastly grown on the media and leading to the contamination. So we'll go one by one of that. So the first fungal contaminant what we are going to discuss now is Aspergillus. So this is a classification of the Aspergillus. It belongs to the subdivision Eumycotina. and subclass, mean the class of the fungal division. It belongs to the class called as Ascomycetes. Now, among these Ascomycetes, it belongs to the order Aspergillales, family Aspergillaceae, and the genus what we are talking about, that is the Aspergillus. So it is an Ascomycetes class fungal organism. Now, so when we talk about the occurrence, where exactly this Aspergillus is found to be, or how it is acting as a contaminant, it is growing basically on the vegetables or on a fatty media, which is going to have the butter, ghee, where the starch or the fatty media is present. Like, for example, on the vegetables, that is rottening of the vegetables which are kept for a longer period of time. So on that vegetables, we can see the growth of this Aspergillus. On the fatty media like butter and ghee, starchy media like bread and rice, preserved food also like jams and jellies, and also on the rottening of certain fruits like oranges. So on all these things, we can see the occurrence. So the common Aspergillus contaminant is basically a foodborne contaminant. That means it is going to invade the food particles, which are all, these are all are the eatables, what we are going to. Next, this is a saprophytic fungus. So we all know what is a saprophytic fungus. That means it is going to decompose the organic matter. So here, whatever all the organic substances or ingredients present in it, it will convert that into simpler forms, and it is going to feed on the organic matter of these food materials, and it is surviving. So, and that's why it is called as a foodborne contaminant. Now we'll see, that is in the lab, in the laboratory, when we are going to culture this Aspergillus from the foodborne or from the food, infected food, what we are collected. So when we culture that on the culture media, the colony, generally the fungal mycelium, it appears like a colony in the on the surface of the culture media. So this Aspergillus family or this Aspergillus fungal organism, it exhibit a greenish and spoky patches on the culture media or on the moist bread, or other sometimes it can be like appear like yellow, black and blue color patches. Okay, so by this coloration on the substratum, wherever it is growing, we can easily identify it as the Aspergillus infection. So the bread, when we keep it, when we put the bread for a longer period of time, so we can observe on the bread like some powdery or greenish powdery or smoky patches on that. So that is the Aspergillus. Next. So when we observe that under the microscope, the mycelium, what is the morphology of this Aspergillus? So if we observe under the microscope, we can see the mycelium, it is made up of interwoven mass of branched and septate hypha. So the mycelium, when we observe under the microscope, you can see here, it is a branched mycelium and all the branches are interwoven among themselves. And the branches here, the hypha is a septate. You can see the presence of the septa in the hyphae. And these hyphae, they are branched and form the mat of the substratum. That means to say, as I told you, these contaminants, they are very fastly grown. So these branches, the hyphae, they keep on branching and they'll be spreading their base. They're acting like a mat on the substratum. They appear just like a greenish color mat on the substratum due to the production of more number of branches and branching. These branches are interwoven over each other. So due to that, it appears just like a mat. Now, from the hyphae, at the type of reproduction, we can see the formation of the reproductive organs. So what is that? We'll see in the next slide. So through this hyphae, it produces the rhizoids from the base of the septa, and from that septa and the branches, they will going to absorb the food material from the substratum. So suppose if it is growing on the bread, so from the bread it will take the carbohydrate content, it will absorb the carbohydrate content, and then it keep on branching and producing the mycelium. Now next, at the time of reproduction, that means the mycelium growing and it want to produce the spores, and it want to increase the intensity of that contamination, so they are going to develop the stalk like structure. So from the base or from the mat of the mycelium, they are going to produce a stalk like structure, what we call it as conidiophore. Now on this conidiophore, we can see the at the end of this conidiophore, we can see the sporangium, or it is called as a vesicle, which is in the form of a globose form. Now around this globose, we can see the formation of the conidia. These conidia, they will be in the form of chains. Okay, these are the spores. Conidia are the spores which are going to be developed at the time of asexual reproduction. Now these conidia, they are arranged one above the other on the basal or a bulbous small structures, they call it as stigmata. On that we can see the development of these spores, which are called as conidia. So conidia are the root cause for the propagation or for the multiplication of the new mycelium. Now this conidiophore, it has length of around 2.5 millimeters, and it is going to swell up at the tip and forming a globose structure, what we are talking about, the vesicle. Now from the vesicle, it going to form the tubular cells, which are called as stigmata, and over the stigmata they develop the chains of conidia, which are the spores resulting in the formation of the new mycelium. Now so when we are going to consume this infected food or the contaminant, this aspergillus, when it is going to enter into our body, it is going to cause a disease called as aspergillosis. So this is a disease mainly caused by the secretion of the poisonous substance released from this aspergillus. We are calling them as mycotoxins, hence that's why we are calling it as a contaminant. Now example, this is also going to cause the infection in the human ear, which is called as otomycosis also. So that is regarding the first contaminant, that is the aspergillus, causing the disease aspergillosis. Now next we are going further, another contaminant of the fungal group, which we call it as neurospora. So even this neurospora, it is also belonging to the class called as ascomycetes, belonging to the order Spiraeales and the family Sordariaceae. So this neurospora fungal organism is the model fungal organism among the microorganism. Model. Why I'm calling it as a model? Because the neurospora strain is generally used in the genetical studies, just like Drosophila. So in the Drosophila, we call it as the nodal organism for conducting or performing any genetical disease or any genetical experiments. In the same way, among the fungal group, this neurospora is considered to be as the nodal organism for genetical studies. So why? Because it is going to produce the ascospores in the formation of a fruiting body called as ascus. So generally it's going to produce 8 ascospores in that acai. So that helps in studying of the recombinant studies like tetrad analysis, that is the genetical basic studies based on the ascospore, how they are produced in the acai. Now so this neurospora Psittophila, this is an species which is known as red bread mold or bakery mold. So the name itself implies this is a common contaminant we are going to absorb on the bread in the or in the baking industry. Now this neurospora actually it is residing on the soil surface or on the papaya or on the burned vegetation, etc. So when you talk about the morphology, it is also a well branched multicellular septate mycelium with a very important point here. It is each cell is a multinucleate. Mycelium is branched mycelium, multicellular, that means to say it is a septate, and in each cell we are going to absorb the multinucleate, many number of nuclei in the cell, and multipigmented also. That means to say it consists of certain pigments in that. So when we talk about the reproduction, so asexually this neurospora is reproducing by two types of conidia. They are macroconidia and the microconidia. So macroconidia, the name itself implies the size of the conidia a little bit are larger. The shape of it is oval and multinucleate. So they are going to develop on the branched tips, which are called as macroconidiophores. And here the microconidia, when we talk about, these conidia are very, very smaller. We can see the presence of only a single nuclei. And then they are developing on these stalk-like structures, what we call it as microconidiophores. So this is a structure, we can see the image. So these are the conidia, which are oval in shape and developed on the conidiophore. This is a stalk of the conidia, that is a conidiophore developing from the mycelium, and it is going to produce these conidia. These are of macro type. Micro, you can see here, this is only a single, smaller in size, oval in shape and uninucleate. Now, sexual reproduction, that means these are the, as I said, this, it is going to belonging to the ascomycetes. They are going to develop a female sexual organ called as ascogonia at the time of sexual reproduction, which is called as the female sexual organ. But here there is no male sexual organ discovered, but only the conidia, they will act like the male organs for fusion with this ascospores. Now this is the ascogonia structure. You can see in this ascogonia, these are the ascospores developed on a stalk-like structure. Now these ascospores, they will fuse with the conidia and forming the secondary structure, what we call it as the zygospore or a zygote. That will result in the formation of a new mycelium. Now here, the upper cells of the ascogonium, that is a, you can see here that a long hair-like structure, what we call it as a trichogyne, is going to absorb. So that is a fruiting body. Here, this is a hyphae. On the hyphae, this is a fruiting body called as ascogonium or a female sexual organ. From this, one of the cell is modified as a long tapering structure, what we call it as trichogyne. To absorb, the main function of this trichogyne is to attract the microconidia or the microconidia, which are acting like the male reproductive or sexual organs called as the spermatia. Now the spermatia, these conidia, they are going to fuse with the ascospores, which are present in this ascogonium, now and develop into the zygote. Now, this zygote is a diploid. It is undergoing reductional division and producing spore tetrads, which we call it as the resulting in the formation of 8 ascospores here in this manner. So as they are produced in the tetrad, 4 towards upper side and 4 towards the lower side. So due to this, what we call it as arrangement of these ascospores in this assay, they are playing a very important role in the genetical studies of the tetrad analysis. So this is a life cycle of neurospora. So these are all the 8 ascospores whatever are developed in this fruiting body, what we call it as asci. This is a mature ascus. This is a what we call it as a female organ, female sexual organ, what we call it as the ascogonia. Now, the next contaminant, what we are going to study now, that is the bread mold, black bread mold, a common name, which is of Rhizopus. So we all are familiar, right, from our childhood, we are studying about this Rhizopus, which is commonly called as the bread mold. Now, so this is a decayed bread. On this, you can see here the black color, all the powdery mass observed on this bread. What this is the Rhizopus, okay, the fungal organism, which is a contaminant causing the decay of the organic matter, the black mold. So this is the structure of the Rhizopus under the microscope. Now we'll go for the morphological structure of the Rhizopus. So the common species of Rhizopus, which is causing the contamination, we call it as the Rhizopus tolonifer. So commonly called as black bread mold. So when we observe the mycelium or the thallus of this fungal organism, it appears like white cottony mass, and the mycelium is branched mycelium. Now it is differentiated, this mycelium is differentiated into nodes and internodes. The nodal region bears branched rhizoids at the base of it, by which it is anchored. So with the help of these rhizoids, it gets sticked or anchored to the substratum for absorbing the food material from the substratum, which is a bread. Now from the internodal regions here, they are acting like the stolons for propagation. Now from this nodal region, you can see, and here this is the complete hypha is aseptate. You can see, you can't see any septa over here. So the central region is occupied by a large vacuole. We can see the presence of oil droplets and many nuclei, multinucleate structure. Now this Rhizopus, it is going to reproduce by four methods. One is called as fragmentation, and asexual method is by the formation of sporangiospores or the chlamydospores, and the sexual method is by gametangial copulation. So as we all know, what is fragmentation? So when the mycelium, when it gets detached from the main mycelia, the hypha will having the capacity to regenerate into the or it will develop into produce the branches and propagating into the new mycelium. So asexual reproduction, when we talk about here in the asexual reproduction mode, so from the stolon, when we talk about the stolon and the type of asexual reproduction, they are developing the stalk-like structures, what we call it as the sporangiophore. So from the sporangiophore, the base of the sporangiophore will get swollen, or it becomes a oval shaped something like this due to the accumulation of more number of nuclei and the food material of this complete sporangiophore. They all will get accumulated at the tip of the sporangiophore. Now, and another important point here is in this swollen region, we call it as a sporangium. We can see it is different, this complete sporangium, what we are talking about, it is getting separated by a central layer. That means to say the sporangium is getting separated from the rest of the mycelia by this a partition in the center. So above the partition in the sporangium, you can see there are many number of nuclei, and each nuclei will develop into, by developing a cell wall around itself, transform into a sporangiospore. Now each sporangiospore, beyond germination, develops into a new mycelium again. So this is a asexual means of reproduction we can observe in the Rhizopus. Now when we go for the sexual life cycle, the sexual reproduction here, it is carried out by the help of gametangial copulation, we call it as. So that means when the mycelia wants to undergo sexual cycle, now from the mycelia, the opposite strains, that is a plesiostrain or a mycostrain, we can designate or differentiate it as plus and minus. They are going to develop small bulbous notches like this develop. When these two strains, when they come in contact, we call them as progametangia. They come in contact and these progametangia, they exchange their cellular material and fusion will occur. So that we call it as a copulation. That is combining of both the gametangia together. And due to that formation, a fruiting body or a reproducing body will develop. That we call it as zygospore. Now from this zygospore, again, we can see the formation of the germ sporangium or a sporangia-like structure developed from it, through which the spores are going to release. These spores will germinate and produce a new mycelium again. So that's how the sexual and the asexual mode of reproduction occurs in rhizopus. Now, next we are going to the next contaminant of the fungal contamination, that we call it as the mucor. So now we all are aware of this mucor. It is becoming a hot topic in this corona pandemic period. So we all are now talking about black fungus, red fungus. Okay, so this is the organism, fungal organism, due to the contamination causing the disease called as a mucor mycosis. So it belongs to the class of fungi which is called as zygomyces or zygomycota, belonging to it, and this belongs to the order Mucorales and the family Mucoraceae. So the contaminant, it is going to generally appears on the damp horse dung or in the soil, but generally present it is a soil borne fungal organism growing on the soil or on the bread and other food material. When we talk about this structure here, so the mycelium, it is also a branched fungi or branched hyphae it consists of, and these hyphae, they are white in color and it is aseptate. You can't see any septa here. Aseptate and multinucleate. Now, next comes, at the time of reproduction, from this vegetative mycelium, we can see the development of the sporangiophore and the sporangia. And one peculiar character of this mucor is, at the time of reproduction, when it is going to form the sporangia, the sporangium appears just like a black pin-like structure. That is, the coloration of the sporangium is black in color, and it just appears like a pin, the head of the pin, whatever we are using in our day-to-day life. So it appears just like a knob of the pen, which is like a black in color. So that is a sporangia. Now the sporangia, it is going to produce a sporangiospores for reproduction. So vegetatively, it is also reproducing with the help of fragmentation and also with the help of chlamydospores. Asexual reproduction is carried out with the help of these spores. Now, just now I told you, the spores which are developed in this sporangia, the black color sporangia, these spores are subjected to be present at the tip of the sporangia, but not, and these spores are get separated from the central columellar region. So that is a basic identification of the mucor differing from the rhizopus. Next, these are spores. How are they? They are non-motile. They are oval in shape and contains a single layer of cell wall. These spores, when they germinate, they're producing a germ tube. So from this tube, they develops into the mycelium. Now here, the sexual reproduction, just like rhizopus, this also occurs through gametangial copulation, where the two strains of the hyphae, they produce gametangia. These gametangia, they couple with each other or they come in contact with each other, exchange the cellular contents and transform into the zygospore. Now this zygospore will develop the sporangiophore as well as the sporangium, through which the spores are going to be liberated, and these spores on germination produce the mycelium. So as this is a very much contaminant causing the disease, what we call it as mucor mycosis, So in this disease, the mortality rate is ranging from 50% to 85%. So when we talk what type of the disease infection causing in the human being, when you talk about, so it is related to rhinocerebral disease, or it is causing pulmonary disease, or even gastrointestinal, or disseminated, or cutaneous. So we look at one about the other. So in the case of whenever it is going to infect either through sinuses or nasal passages or through the oral cavity, it is going to cause the disease in the cerebral area of our brain and causing the disease leading to the death also. So the attack here is mainly due to the in the people who are having low immunity. This is regarding the in the case of rhinocerebral case. When you talk about the pulmonary, it is a basic or very often caused by this mucor, the pulmonary infection. So the this mucor, it enters into the patient through the oral or through the nasal or through the throat, and it is causing the disease. And the symptoms what we often see is fever, cough, chest pain, or the pleural effusion causing the disease of pulmonary aspergillosis. So here generally it is through inhalation or through the cutaneous also. So basically the spores which are released from this mucor are the basic cause of infection. So that's why nowadays, as the coronavirus is causing through the pulmonary infection, even this mucor is also entering into the corona patients through the respiratory tract and causing the pulmonary infections in their body. Now, it can also lead to the gastrointestinal disease also. The symptoms, what you can see here is abdominal pain or bowel obstruction or the bloody diarrhea or vomiting also. So here also the cause of the infection, the risk of the infection is mainly due to the less immunity in our body. And this is a common occurring in the children. Next we go for the cutaneous, that is when it is occurring or growing on the skin. So the infected skin causes, appears reddish and swollen nature. So we can see that patches are very painful. And here, this patient, the generally this cutaneous mucor mycosis is occurring generally due to the low antigen antibodies like IgA and IgG in our body. So only treatment we can see here is either by skin therapy or by transplantation of the infectious skin with the normal skin over there where the infection has been occurred. So this is about the four general contaminants of the fungal organism, what we can see mainly causing in the culture group of the any food material or in the food industry. So we talked about here, this is regarding the mucor. Next, we talked about rhizopus, then neurospora, and the first one we discussed about aspergillus. So these are the four contaminants, what is there in your syllabus, their morphology, the mode of contamination, and their reproduction. So just I'm stop sharing. Right. So thank you, participants. So with this, we ended with our unit 2 of our certificate course. So I hope you all have enjoyed my session. And from Monday onwards, you'll be going with dealing with the third.